Castoriadis is mainly remembered and quoted in the philosophical literature and among intellectuals as a political thinker, either for his analysis of the Soviet system or for his general view about democracy and the evolution of societies. But it is important to remember that he was not just a political thinker, he was also a philosopher in the full sense of the term. And I think one should pay more attention, and maybe it will happen in the future, when one should be interested in his views about general topics like being. It's not obvious for to think of Castoriadis as doing metaphysics, but that's what he has done in his views about the fact that being has always been interpreted in the tradition as determination, as being something with fixed limits and properties, and that these views was a distortion of reality. This is a topic I have dealt with in a paper about Castoriadis on the principle of determination, and it goes very far in the heart of philosophy. Either we think that indetermination is a failure on our part to define what is existing, or we accept that in reality itself there is a part of indetermination, which is a part of the future, the part of the becoming something else. On this topic, Castoriadis was very critical of contemporary views in logic and even in mathematics. And these are topics that are not dealt with so often by general philosophers, because they are not dealing enough with the questions about, for instance, in mathematics, the theory of sets, set theory, or with the conditions of the philosophical conditions for theoretical physics. And Castoriadis was confronting these problems. And in that respect, he is a full philosopher, not just a political intellectual, but a full philosopher at the same level as the greatest in the 20th century. Well, first, a clarification of this idea of self-limitation. Castoriadis' idea was that democracy means responsibility. He was opposing the true democratic way of self-government with government organized on the basis of a religious law or a metaphysical view of the world. Democracy means that we are not responsible towards God or towards anything for political matters. These political matters are our own matters. We have to decide for ourselves, which means that if we make mistakes, these mistakes are our own mistakes. We should not complain that God was not kind with us and he has treated us badly. We should not complain because we are the origin of our own disasters. That's his idea, which means that there is, in the very idea of democracy, a danger. It's the danger which was meant in ancient Greek by the word hybris. Hybris, that is to say, illimitation of the of the desire, of the will, idea that I am all powerful, I can do whatever I want. So the idea of self-limitation is the idea that democracy needs some kind of wisdom. And this wisdom has to do with the realization that human institutions, human life, and everything in this world is contingent. The things are not predetermined in a rational way, they are contingent, and it's very easy to destroy what is existing by not paying attention to situations. So this is the idea of self-limitation, and the question was, is there in the modern democracy, as opposed to the ancient democracy, is there a principle of self-limitation? So you are asking, do we have this self-limitation mechanism right now? Well, people sometimes think we have that principle with human rights. And they think that political liberalism is enough to provide the self-limitation we need as soon as we define the people, the demos, as the last authority on any matters. It's very frightening if you think of it, because if the demos takes crazy decisions, then there is no way you can oppose these decisions, since they are democratic. Is political liberalism enough? Well, Castoriadis would not deny that political liberalism is a better way to deal with problems than an authoritarian regime, of course. Of course not, but it is not enough. And the way he was pointing that fact, pointing to the fact that it was not enough, was by opposing the democratic project, which is a political view, with the Western project of domination of nature and being in any way possible. And this project was precisely the hybris of modernity, with the ecological consequences that we know, and now not just consequences for the environment, but consequences for the human being itself, himself, with the fact that biology and science make it possible for human being to reprogram itself somehow. So what was needed in his view was more paideia, more education in order to keep in mind that we are finite beings and with limits, and we should never forget about our limits. Well, this volume, this book, collective book about Nietzscheanism, was not really a book about Nietzsche himself, the philosopher. It was a book about the rise and the success in the intellectual opinion of Nietzscheism, the complex of ideas. And in my piece, I was discussing the French reception of Nietzsche and the way it has been used in the French debate. So not Nietzsche, the philosopher, the German philosopher, but the French philosopher, and especially Deleuze. And I was struck by the fact that Deleuze, in his book about Nietzsche, was opposing two ways of thinking about the individual. The individual in the sense of individualism, in the sense of an ethical ideal of individual freedom. According to Deleuze, there were two ways of thinking about the individual. One way was the Kantian way, and that was the way of self-responsibility. In Kant, the human subject, so the human person, is responsible towards himself. I have duties not towards the other, but toward myself. I am indebted to myself. That's the idea of the moral law inside my moral conscience. That's the Kantian way. And completely at the opposite, we had Nietzsche's way of thinking about the individual, and that was the idea that the individual is free as soon as this individual is irresponsible. That the idea that he should not answer to any kind of authority, including the authority of his own conscience. And so in my piece about in that volume, I was criticizing the idea of irresponsibility, and this is why Castoriadis called me actually and told me he was very happy with my criticism, because it was about responsibility. And this goes to the point we discussed before that one. At the center of his thinking is the fact that we are responsible. We are not responsible in a religious way. We are responsible because we are on our own. And responsibility meant not that we are, it meant essentially that we are no longer children, we are adults, and we should behave like responsible adults. So somehow, if you think of it, the Kantian way of thinking about the individual, that's too much responsibility, because the idea is that at any moment I am responsible for the world, the whole of the world, that's the universal responsibility. It's crazy, because I cannot be responsible for everything that happens in the world. But on the other hand, in the Nietzschean way, there was not enough responsibility. And I think that Castoriadis was right in saying that I cannot be responsible for everything, but I have to be responsible for what is really depending on myself. And here Castoriadis was happy to reproduce the Aristotle view that there are indeed events that are ephemin in ancient Greek, that are up to us. There are things not everything is up to us, but there are indeed events that depend on the way we are deciding either to do things or not to do them. And there is what he called a human domain, that's the domain of our own responsibility. There is a difference here, not in the general views, but Castoriadis was thinking, well, in his analysis of modernity, he was analyzing the Western civilization, and the crisis of identification he's speaking of is a crisis which is happening in any modern society, which means, first of all, in the United States, and a little later in Europe. My own speech about the European identity was something much more restrained, because I was speaking of the European Union, not the Western civilization as a whole, but just the political future of the European Union. There is nevertheless a common point, which is the following. Castoriadis was, in his book, the Rise of, I don't know how it's in English, the Rise of Insignificance, maybe, La Montée de l'Insignifiance, the Rise of Nonsense. He was not just pointing out a void in the current civilizations, which is preventing identification. He was pointing out a destruction of the very conditions for civilization. And he was saying that, he was giving examples, saying that how come that we still have teachers, for instance, or nurses in the hospital, That is to say, people who make a job for not a, not for a big salary because they are not well paid, but just because they respect the job they are doing. Being a nurse or being a teacher, being a doctor, this is not a matter of making a lot of money. It's a matter of being excellent in a human function, which is which has sense, which gives meaning to what you do. And he said that, if we go on the on this tendency towards commodification, then there is no reason we will still have teachers, nurses, doctors, professors, philosophers, but the civilizations rest upon these kinds of people. So he concluded that in the present state of the Western civilization, we were going to self-destruction, because without having something else in mind than financial success, we could not go on in a civilized way. Well, this has to do with the future of Europe, because one worry we should have about the future of Europe is, will it will maintain its diversity, which is part of what makes meaningful Europe, that's a diversity of ideas, cultures within the same civilization. If Europe is just an economic space, with of course juridical regulations, that is to say abstract and universal regulations, well, an economic space of free exchange and commercial treaties does not give meaning to what we do. And Europe can be meaningful for people, can be there can be an identification to Europe on the condition that it keeps its richness of cultures and diversity. The way he describes this building of a wall makes one think of the movie Zardoz. People living in an artificial happy civilization with no conflict, but they keep other people off this happy space by a wall. And at some point in the movie, you see the external people trying to get in, and they are kept off by the wall, by a transparent wall. So he was certainly thinking of a situation where the well-off societies will say we stay with each other and we forget about the rest of the world, and if they want to come in, we will prevent them from coming. Our situation is not at all the same, because at this point it's the opposite. The European leaders are the ones who want more people coming in Europe in order to replace the people who are lacking because of the demographic trend, which is less babies, more seniors, at least in Germany. And in Brussels, there are experts making plans and trying to figure out how many more workers from outside we should import in Europe. But of course, in the societies where these immigrants would come, people all over there are not very happy with this idea, because it means more unemployment, or at least a downgrading of the salaries. That's the necessary result of such a policy. So at this point, it's not the elites which want to keep migrants outside and workers who have a sense of solidarity with other workers, it's the opposite. It's the leaders who want more immigrants because they observe that in Germany, for instance, there are not enough people to keep all the jobs. And instead of reforming the family policy in Germany by making easier for women to have babies and still have a professional life, they say the solution is more gastarbeiter, more foreign workers. But more foreign workers in the first, at least in the short term, means more competition for the salaries, for the jobs, and more unemployment. And this is so it's quite natural. It was to be expected that these flows of external workers would lead to reactions which are not, of course, very pleasant to observe. But it should not be a surprise to observe the situation like that. So I think that on this point, the analysis we should make right now is not the one we would have made in the last century, because the situation was at that time quite different. We are living with the effects of the war President Bush decided to have in the Middle East, and that was not the case, that was not yet the case at the end of the last century.